It's the biscuit. Hello, biscuit babies. It's time for the biscuit. I'm your host, William Bartram. And today's guest is Les Borsheim. I'm very excited to talk to him. His story is absolutely fucking fascinating. But before we get into that, I want you to get into a hairless ape conspiracy shirt. You know, I've said they're a t-shirt company, but they're more than that. They're a website of badass people helping people with philosophies, ideologies, ideas, and just motivation to be the best human that you can be. I really recommend you go check out hairlessapeinc.com. And if you want to get a shirt, I suggest you do that too. Use the promo code BISCUIT10 at checkout and save yourself 10% off. You won't regret it. Best shirt I've ever worn. I'm not lying. I don't lie. And we're also brought to you by ParkersPlatoon.org. Stanley Cup champion Scott Parker and his family. Their nonprofit organization to help one veteran at a time. Go check them out at ParkersPlatoon.org. And as always, we are presented by HockeyFights.com. Go to HockeyFights.com. Rate fights, watch fights, get drunk, have a good time. Again, very excited to have Les Borsheim on today. Enjoy.
Now Probert got the right hand free.
He's loose with the right hand, and he starts to retaliate, and down goes Nyland, and the two of them are hammering each other.
Knights of Columbus, that hurt!
It's old time hockey.
Enforcer of all hockey podcasts. It's the biscuit. It's the biscuit.
Damn it! The goal regulation size of one!
The enforcer of all hockey podcasts.
God help the fucking day if fighting's ever banned. As a country will stop working on some badness fucking can.
Hi everybody. It's the biscuit podcast.
Hey, wanna go? Yeah, okay. Good luck, man.
All right, biscuit babies. Tonight we're joined by Les Borsheim, the man meat himself, the man with 87 career fights, over 1,000 pims in the Central Hockey League, former Brandon Wheat King, Philadelphia Phantom, and forever a Colorado Eagle in my eyes. How we doing, Les?
Good. Well, thanks for having me on, buddy.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. How you been doing?
I'm doing well here, hanging in Colorado. Pretty fair weather. Having a good winter so far. Training my ass off at the gym and trying to get better, small improvements, and then working with the Eagles as well on the radio, and they're having about a 500 season, but it's been fun. A lot of young talent, and a new league in the AHL we just moved up to, so pretty exciting.
Yeah, I wanted to ask you how that's going. It doesn't happen very often where teams just jump up like that. Has it been accepted well in the AHL, the fans all into it and everything?
Oh, yeah, man. The fans this year have been unbelievable. It's been packed again. I mean, we've always had great fans here in Colorado, especially back in the day when they first came here in this Central Hockey League and they're running the rule. And it was filled up pretty good all the time that year, those years. But this year, the fans have been really good. And the movement is to Denver with the Avalanche and seeing the kids go back and forth. I think fans really accepted it and they're enjoying it. And they realize, oh, man, I remember when I played in the AHL in the jungle, and it was more meatheads and running around and doing their thing. But, I mean, these kids now, it's pretty sick, the talent, how fast and how creative they are and what they do out there. They're pretty good.
Yeah, for sure.
And the fans realize that, too, and they're enjoying it. So, we'll see. We just got to get on the winning streak here and hopefully make playoffs.
Yeah, absolutely. It's got to be nice for the boys, too, you know, the ones that are close to getting called up or do get called up, when you don't have to travel from Utica to Vancouver to get that call up.
Yeah, I mean, it's, you know, Coley gets sick or whatever, as a guy goes down in Denver, it's pretty quick and convenient. I mean, it's like when I was in Philadelphia there in the Phantoms with the Flyers and we're in the same practice rink. I mean, you're around the big boys all the time and you're right there. It's super convenient. I mean, you even get called up for practice if the Flyers were short. You go out there and buzz around with the big boys. And it's, I mean, now it's super convenient in Philadelphia just being the same arena in the same city. But, yeah, it's a 50-minute drive for the boys to go down and lace them up with the Avalanche. So that proximity is super crucial and pretty cool to watch when you see the boys on the big screen and in the show doing their thing. And when they played the other night here in the BC here in Loveland.
Yeah, it's got to make it a little less awkward for the guys, too, once they get in the room, you know, with the big guys that, you know, they've seen him at practice, you know, for those call-ups, and it's not like, you know, who the fuck is this guy in the room? They might be more familiar with the guys.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, that familiarity, and it's just the proximity of being able to be that close, and obviously the camps they held were pretty tight-knit and for a few more extra days just because the team, the Triple A team, is right here. So I think they did get that bond a bit more. So you're right. Like, when the guy gets called up, he's not just walked into a locker room of complete strangers. So right. He goes to the boys. And I think for the transformation and getting them called up, it makes it a little bit more comfortable for a kid that's young, you know, going up to play in the show. A lot more comfortable for him because they know the boys they've been battling with and practicing with. So yeah, I think that's a good element.
Oh, I think so too. I would hope more teams can adopt that. I know in some cases it's impossible, but you know, like the Blue Jackets have Cleveland, you know, an hour and a half north, or, you know, 2 hours max. So they, like you said, they get players to come down for practice all the time because that's a nothing jog, you know what I mean? And it's right down one highway. It's not a big deal at all.
Yeah, I mean, and I remember when I called up to Philadelphia coming from Oklahoma, shit. I think I flew out that morning, didn't sleep the night before because you're nervous, and you get to Philadelphia, get cleared by the doctor, jump on the bus, and I think that's the only sleep I got to go to Hershey. But yeah, that proximity and having to do that drive, if you know, cross country, it makes it a lot harder on a guy getting called up if you had to do that.
Now, how did you get into the radio gig?
Honestly, my 1 year I lived with a radio guy here in Colorado that did a radio for a while, and whenever I was suspended or whatever, he'd have me on. and I'd jump on there once in a while. And then just when I got out of the hospital from, being paralyzed and my accident, I tried coaching first year when I was out. And I just loved being around the boys and being a mentor for them and helping them out. But just arenas weren't that wheelchair accessible.
Yeah.
So in the meantime, I was doing with the Eagles. I'd do a Boris's breakdown between the first and second period for like 5 minutes, go on the air, go down there and, spit my 5 cents on the air. And then after that, about 3 years doing that, they had me on full time for gigs on the radio, and super easy, super convenient. And I love doing, just put a headset on, add some comedy, some, you know, sense from a player that was out there and what they're doing and thinking and battling through in that perspective. And it's worked out real well. And,
oh, yeah.
Good to be involved with hockey, too. And now, you know, especially, like, we're in the AAA now, so step below the show. And, you know, I talked to Mark Mosier and Lauren Gardner and Peter McDabb, some of the guys that do the NHL and the Avalanche. So you got that tight-knit kind of, you know, community. And know those guys. So it's been good. Now when I watch a hockey game, shit, I listen to the color gun man and the radio guys a bit more than watching the hockey and trying to take tips and things they do. But yeah, it's been a super good transformation, really good way for me to stay involved with the hockey.
Well, you're perfect for the gig. You were a fan favorite there for the Eagles, and just getting over there and, you know, having that personality, you know, like how you played the game is going over into how you call games too. I mean, you can't help but reek of personality. It's just the way you are. I think, you know, being that fan favorite and then the people listening too, I mean, I'll find myself listening to games. I'll have the radio on and watch the game just because I like the radio guys better. Especially if a national televised game, you're just like, oh my God, dude, it's the same thing every game. The radio guys really seem to know the team more and can maybe be a little more free than the TV guys.
Yeah, you know, and look at even fucking TV. I mean, part about it I love is all the, you know, meatheads, supposedly, all the fighters back in the day or whatever, even, you know, a couple of years ago that were fighting. How many of those guys are on the radio or on TV now?
Oh, they're the best ones.
Yeah, because they got that personality. And I mean, they weren't stupid. They knew the game. And, you know, you can talk about and add that comedian or, you know, that insight to the game with a little bit of, you know, fun and insight that's not just lame and boring. But that's what I love. Like, all these guys are doing it now are fucking former fighters. A lot of guys are just grinding out, fighting a lot. In typical, prototypical, you know, like called meatheads or whatever on the ice you think of. But they have so much personality now. They're doing the TV and the radio gigs, and it's pretty cool to see.
Absolutely. Yeah, you guys are really the best ones at it. And it's it's got to feel good to be around the rink and around the boys and continue on, you know, being as close to the, as hockey as you possibly can.
Yeah, you know, you go down there for pregame skate or practice and whatnot, and talk to the boys, get to know them a bit, you know, and festivities after. Sometimes you're still involved with the team. So, yeah, it's just been good. I mean, it's not the same, obviously, not being in that locker room, the competition, and having that, you know, camaraderie between the boys when you're battling. But, I mean, you still feel involved. You're around hockey, you're around the rink. So, yeah, it's hard. I mean, you listen to guys after hockey, you don't know what the fuck to do, and you get lost, kind of, and you definitely miss that part a lot. It's just, you talk to anyone who quit hockey, they miss hockey and the competition, but the thing about it is the boys and everything. And yeah, I mean, I'm still involved, not quite as tight knit with all the boys in the locker room, but still get to go to the rink and practice and fuck around and you know, trash on the guys when they see it. They'll rip on each other, and it's great.
Hell yeah. And you know, we talked last night a little bit, and you were saying that you had just rehabbed all day. Now, how does that work? Are you able to move enough to are you seeing gains? I mean, I'm sure most of the people that are listening are familiar that you had a pretty devastating motorcycle accident that left you paralyzed in the arms and legs.
Yeah, I mean, fuck, when I got out, I mean, after my accident, it was pretty bad. Obviously, I was C4, C5, quadriplegic, and technically the doctors said I'd be at best on a sip and puff wheelchair where you got the straw and you blow into a drive and all this shit. I mean, they always do that, but, you know, I started seeing gains. I couldn't move anything but my left arm a bit after my accident. That was it. I could wiggle my toes a bit, but yeah, go to therapy, and after the first 2 years, I got my right arm back and a lot more movement, and it's something, physical therapy, it's not going to heal me. Like, it's not going to make me walk. That's going to be a medical, you know, miracle or whatever, surgery, something, hopefully down the line that happens and they can figure out. But yeah, definitely getting a lot stronger, staying healthy. I mean, it's more for mental too. It's my new locker room down there. Like,
yeah,
I go down there, roll in, I rip on the other clients. The trainers become like family and everything. And I kind of just lose my mind for, you know, a good hour and a half. Hopefully get some metal music on in the gym, which doesn't always happen. It pisses me off. But you got other people in there working out. And, yeah, it's just my new getaway. I mean, that's the other thing. You escape with hockey. And I think that, you know, when you're done playing it, I mean, you get to go to the rink and become someone else for like 4 hours, 5 hours. And it's a good escape and something to throw yourself into. So that's what my therapy's like now for me. I approach it like my new game, my new sheet of ice, kind of, you know, going there every day and just treat like my locker room. When I'm in the gym, I'm just ripping hard, going hard. And yeah, definitely found some a lot stronger, getting my weight back up. I mean, I was down to like, I went from 230 240 to like down to 150 pounds.
Wow.
So I'm back up to like 180 185.
There you go.
Looking bigger, getting stronger, but shit, I haven't been really sick or in the hospital forever. And with the injury and being paralyzed and quadriplegic, everything that comes with it, there's a lot of shit that can happen. You end up in the hospital, so I'm definitely staying healthy. And if there is a miracle that comes along here, man, I'm going to be a fucking first in line because I've been doing the right things here, you know, between the time of my injury and to the present here.
Well, I'm glad to hear that you're keeping out of the hospital and not getting sick. And was there ever a moment, you know, because like you said, the doctors, you know, will give you the worst case scenario just to kind of cover their aspect. Well, you're never going to, did you ever buy into it where you're like, no, fuck that. I'm going to move again. I'm going to, you know, just that athlete mentality and that just being a badass, just going, no, I'm going to do something with this.
Yeah, I mean, it was good. I mean, fucking being told you're not going to be able to do it, that's a big motivator. I mean, someone tells you you can't do it, I mean, most people, it'll motivate. And it helped me, like, being an athlete and doing what I did, God, I mean, with my therapy and my rehab, I mean, definitely that mindset and everything as an athlete definitely helped me, push me a little bit harder, a little bit farther, maybe get some gains back more. But definitely something... fuck, I'm not going to lie, first 2 years were real hard. I mean, it mean I had to relive that day, you know, and wish I could redo it in a different way. And mentally, I had to get over that part of it. And, you know, there was some depression, obviously. And
yeah.
I mean, you go from being playing pro hockey, going to the rink every day with the boys to a whole brand new life, obviously trying to learn how to live in a wheelchair and everything that comes with that, and then losing hockey as well. So it was a big leaf to turn over. It's heavy, man.
Oh, it's got to be a mind fuck. Like you said, you went from being a jack, like big 240 yeah. dude, even to just watch your body change that drastically.
Oh, yeah. I almost threw up when I looked in the mirror. Fuck, the first time looking at myself, I was like, oh.
Well, you probably hadn't been that small since fucking grade school. You know?
That's been a while, man. That was a shocker. Definitely it was battle. It was a big time battle, but fuck, I was lucky, man. I hit my head pretty hard. The doctors like told me I got one good hit left of my head because fuck, all the concussions I had through hockey and then flying off a Harley, fuck, no helmet, and bashed my head. Technically, they said a brain injury, fuck, but you know, probably did my whole life if playing hockey could have said that, but yeah, the doctors just said you had a brain injury, so. That's something else. It was scary, and I was lucky, man. Fuck, blessed to be alive. It could have turned out so much worse. So,
now
that's one thing. You got to stay positive, and
yeah, you have to. Yeah. Do you remember the accident at all, or did you just remember coming to in the hospital?
Shit, we took a stop, took a picture. Like I think it was like 10, 15 minutes before my accident, and that's the last thing I remember.
Really?
I don't remember shit. So it happened June 1st. And then my first memory is July 1st because the nurses at the hospital put like Happy Canada Day on the chalkboard kind of thing, dry erase board at the end of my bed. So that was my first real memory. So I lost a month of my life. Damn. And it was induced coma a bit too. They kept me heavily medicated as well. But yeah, 1 month just gone. Don't remember anything from my accident, which might be a good thing. It might be pretty traumatic to have to live that over again.
Yeah.
Can't remember it. So yeah, 1 month I was just out of it and gone. So no memory of my memory at all or accident at all. So I don't know what the hell happened, but
well, that's, you know, that's where your story is really familiar to me. I know the listeners, they know, my father passed away when I was 3 on a Harley accident, got hit by a deer when he was going to get coffee with his buddy. And was alive. I think, like I said, I was 3, so I don't really remember, but my mom will tell stories every now and again, but was alive for like 9 days on like life support, and it was just like he didn't remember anybody and just all this like fucked up stuff. It's just like, oh my God. So it's nice to see that not only that you recovered and that you're being positive about it and turning it into something that can help people and keep people motivated.
Yeah, and you know, that's what I did, some motivational speaking to kids and everything, and that was one main thing, you know, I'd hit on, I'd talk to the kids, but the first thing I'd break into it, I'd be like, hey, if one of you kids can take something from my message today and use it as a positive in your life down the line or change your life a bit, that'll give my tragedy some purpose. And that's all I'm trying to do. And
yeah,
today with my speech, just turn my tragedy into a positive for one of you kids out there. Use something I say today and make your life better with it. So, yeah, it's something that, fuck, you gotta realize how blessed you are to survive. And,
right.
You know, motorcycle accidents, fuck.
They're so fucking brutal, man.
Well, that's a majority, too. Like, when I was in the hospital, it was motocross, car accidents, fucking motorcycle mainly, too. And, yeah, they're fun and everything, but they are dangerous in the same right.
And it's, you know, I think that the kids, too, can really grasp it. You're really only given one shot at this life. So, you know, don't take it for granted. You know, get up on it and go. There's no time to waste.
Yeah, and it's really hard to, you know, have that hit home every day. But, God, if you could live life like that every day when you wake up, fuck, man, you could do so much more. But, yeah, definitely is an eye-opener, and especially just small things you can do that are taken away, and just how lucky you are to be able to do some of just the littlest tasks in life that I can't do anymore. But, fuck, when I came out of the hospital, there's so many things I wouldn't do. And now that, fuck, I did them after my accident. I mean, I'm still living, you know, a pretty full life. So, yeah, it's, you have that mindset of being positive. You know, proving the doctors wrong as well was a good motivation to keep me going.
Absolutely, man, absolutely. You know, like it is, what is it, you know, little steps and big prayers, man.
Yeah, fuck, I had a kid come up to me. I was in Oklahoma City. My buddy's, Tyler Fleck, was running a hockey school, and I was visiting the boys back in OKC, and I was sitting out there, and in my power chair at the time. And then, fuck, this girl just came up to me and she's talking to me. She's like, "We need my little brother praying for you every night. We're thinking about you throughout your recovery and your accident." I don't know if I was looking down or what, or not, you know, looking like perky or whatever it was. And she just fucking put her hand on my hand. She's like, "Small steps, big prayers, Les Borsheim. Small steps, big prayers." And that just hit home.
Oof.
But kind of just took that and ran with it.
I wanted to ask you, you know, there seems to be different types of enforcers or tough guys. You know, like, there's the guys who do it to continue to play hockey. There's the guys that do it because they're good. Then there's guys like McGranton who do it because they actually love to do it. Now, I'm going to guess, and tell me if I'm wrong here, but you seemed like one of the guys that really enjoyed doing it.
Yeah, I mean, it was just fun. I mean,
I knew it.
It was just, I mean, you know, there's the stage fights where you're out there and you go pick a fight to change the momentum of a hockey game or whatnot. Or, you know, how it rolls, the referee misses a call, or there's a guy out there running around hitting your skilled players. You got to send a message, or just fucking in the heat of the moment and you lose your mind and kind of, you know, go off on a guy. Yeah, it was fun. I mean, obviously there's a mental toll. Yeah, I know, I listened to Grant's podcast too, and he just loved fucking fighting. I don't think he had a problem with that, but I'm not going to lie, junior hockey as well, throughout pro career, there's days where you're lying in your bed for pre-game sleep or whatnot. You know, there's this fucking 6'5 monster come to town with the team, and you know, might have to fight him, something might happen, and you know, you don't sleep that easy sometimes, so there is that pressure and that uneasiness, but for the most part, I love going out there and losing myself and playing hard and physical, and you know, that rush of that's why I went skydiving basically here after my injury. I mean, that rush of that 10 seconds when you square off the guy and the fans are going crazy and your adrenaline's just hitting the fucking wall 100%, and then you get in the tilt and whatever happens, losing that and that having that release and that escape, you know, that's something I had to replace. So I went skydiving.
Dude, I saw that. You're fucking nuts, man.
Yeah, just down the road. I mean, not kidding, I wasn't completely sober for him. It was good, man. And they're like, "Hey, we're gonna film this shit for free because you're the first quadriplegic we've ever had up here."
How many have ever done it?
Oh, they said I was the first, like full on. Like they had amputees and some paras, like paraplegic, where guys can use their hands and shit. So they had the suit knitted up where they pulled my legs up when he landed and everything.
Okay.
But yeah, they're like, "You're the first fucking full-on quadriplegic that we've had up here, so we're doing your video for sure." And I'm like, "Hell yeah, I'll do that."
Well, and everybody listening, you can see the video. It's on your YouTube page, and it's pretty incredible. I like the part halfway where they're like, "You're halfway there," and you're like, "Well, I'm halfway stoked," or whatever it was. That was fucking funny.
Yeah, no, there's a... It was good, man. Fuck, adrenaline hit the wall. I never ate so much. I was so hungry after that, too. Went partying after that. It was a good day, man. One of the lucky days. One of the things you didn't think you're going to do after you got paralyzed, obviously. And, you know, I did it. Fucking still living. And still full of life. But, yeah, I had to get that adrenaline back. That was the main reason of going out there and jumping out of a perfectly good airplane.
Yeah, dude. I don't even like being up on my roof, man. Let alone jumping out of a fucking plane.
Yeah, it was a good rush. That free fall at the beginning of it was pretty sick, and then just floating down the fucking Rocky Mountains out here is pretty beautiful.
Oh, I can imagine. Are you dropping long enough to really enjoy like the landscape, or is it like pretty quick?
Oh no, fuck, the free fall is quick. I don't even know if it's 30 seconds, and then yeah, when you're floating down there, the dude's like going back and forth, and you're definitely enjoying the ride down and the.
Whew.
In the view and everything. But yeah, I don't know. It's one of the better days.
Does it come into your head like, what? Like, oh shit, what if this parachute doesn't go off?
You know, I don't know. I didn't even cross my mind. I'm like, I'm ready to die today. I said that too. I'm like, I'm ready to die. Let's do this.
Let's do it. Let's fucking go. Let's jump out of planes.
Yeah. Whatever.
Hell yeah, man. Now, you know, you mentioned heavy metal earlier in the show, and I know you said, you know, when you were with your Billet family and Brandon, that, you know, you really connected with your Billet family, learning guitar and playing Deftones out in the freezing garage. Yeah. And just really enjoying heavy metal. And I guess what I'm asking is, like, that's really important for there to find, like, a common thing with a Billet family.
Yeah, Yeah, I mean, I was definitely, I played a little bit of guitar before my cousin, before I went out to Brandon. I learned some licks, tablature, didn't know a whole bunch of chords and all that. But yeah, you go out there and you're living with a family. Actually, the family, it was good because he had coached me in Double A, Bantam, and Humble. So I knew the dad pretty well, and mostly brought the kids too. Their sons, they had three sons. So yeah, when I moved out there, it was a nice transition. The Bill family's huge. I mean, you think of these kids coming over from Europe too.
Yeah.
And how the fuck they do that. And like Brandon, how would these kids, they didn't speak a lick of English. They're learning how fucking watching Mel Gibson movies and Terminator. First words of learner, always swear words. Pretty hilarious. But yeah, it's a hard transition and getting a good billet family and having that, you know, close-knit kind of family on, you know, away from your own family is makes that transition and go to the rink every day a lot more easier. So I've had some good ones and I'm blessed to say it.
Now, how do the families react, you know, when you're in the dub and you're playing a role, you know, a more physical role, and you know, there's going to be nights where you're fighting fucking Todd Fedoric or Steve McIntyre, Josh Mazur. I mean, Derek Bugard, for God's sakes, Darcy Hordachuk. Just, does your family, your billet family, worry about you? Or is it, have they harbored other hockey players? So it's just kind of another day in the life for a billet family. Is that ever playing into a hockey player's mind as you're playing too? Like, oh shit, like my billet, not only is my family worried about me, but these other people who have been taking care of me lately are worried about me too, or is it just so focused on that end game to make it to the show?
Yeah, I mean, when you're at that age and the show's right there and not that far away, you know, people around you obviously care, and you know, they care for you, so you don't want to worry them or put them in a bad situation. But they're hockey set, hockey minded. I mean, he was a head coach, my billet, the dad, so he had that mentality of
there you go,
he knew what it had to take, and you know. I think he fucking told me to fight more almost.
Like, that sounds about right.
He's like, you got to make a name. And like, you got to show up. You got to find a role. And you stick with it. Do the best you can at it. So, yeah, he was a... I don't think he's too worried too much. He was just a hockey dude. He knew what hockey was about back then anyways. Fucking so different now. But back then, yeah. It was... I don't think they were too worried. And they didn't care when I came home with busted up cheekbone from Steven Pete or fucking a
holy shit, that fight is fucking brutal, dude.
Oh man, God, I remember that was one of those games where it's just fucking face off fight. And fucking Bobby Lowe's for my Brandon coach, fuck, he told me to go line up on left wing or right wing. And fuck, I went out left wing and fucking Petey was there because Petey is 16 years old, but he's blasting through the dub fight, Rocky, like fucking hanging in with some big boys.
Yeah.
Getting a rep already. So Losey sent me out there on the wing, but fuck, I didn't listen to him. They're all fans, all poor shots. So I go out there, fucking spirit peeing the balls, and fucking ran out of toe to toe. Fucking, yeah, big right hand to the cheekbone, dropping it in my knee, and fucking Petey. That was my first major concussion for sure from him.
That's all it takes is that one punch, man. I mean, before that, it was pretty toe to toe, but I mean, it's just like, oh shit, there it is. That's all it takes.
Yeah, and I think his fucking arm came right out, right arm came out of his sweater, and fucking just, I was holding nothing but air, and fucking cocked me right in my cheekbone. But yeah, that was my first good concussion. Fucking, thank God, I, you know, bless Petey. We all know what he's going through, and we pray for him. And
yeah,
he's had a tough after, but fuck, one thing, you know, I knew Petey hit my snooze button hard, and fucking, I remember we went to Moose Jaw 2 days later, and I'm on the bus, I'm feeling pretty fucked up still, and go out there and I'm seeing like tracers, fuck, when I'm warming up, like blue things around. And
oh shit.
Oh yeah, it was bad. And I go to the trainer and, you know, tell him. And thankfully, they sat me out for fucking, I think, like a couple weeks because of it, and gave me a little bit of break. And even back then, I mean, that didn't happen often.
No, that's huge on your trainer to have that foresight to at least give you a few weeks off. Because like you said, a lot of guys weren't granted that.
No, I mean, fucking later on in my career it happened. Fucking, I remember my first tilt in Philly was fucking Josh Gratton. And fucking, he was just got called up too, and fucking basically came up to the point, hit me, fucking gloves were off. And just tossing him back and forth. Fuck, but he could take a punch, man.
Holy shit, dude. Yeah, he can. He's a fucking beast.
I was hitting him hard, like licking him hard, but fuck, man, he caught me good. Down to one knee, fucking tooth flew out. And who the fuck's coming to my rescue but Craig Berube? Picking me up, kind of helping me to the penalty box. And then, fuck, I mean, obviously, a concussion, but came out the next period and everything. So, definitely happened in my career, right? Concussion, and I came back that same game or didn't take any rest. But that first one from Petey, yeah, they sat me for a bit, which I'm thankful for, I guess. You know, it's a fucking sad thing that happened to some of the boys, man. It's hard to see. And, I mean, the one thing I know, though, like, fucking after Petey hit me with that punch, I was pretty sure that wasn't good for my brain.
Yeah.
Fucking, that might have some long-term effects if I kept doing it. So, I mean, if I played, I mean, we did play. I mean, with the concussions, I, you know, I have to take some fucking onus and put some on myself for doing that, playing with concussions and the brain injury thing. But, yeah, definitely it's a scary thing, fucking what's going on with the traumatic brain injury and everything. And seeing some of the boys and the after effects. Fuck, you think about the UFC fighters. What?
Oh, man, when these studies start coming out on them here in, you know, 20 years, it's going to be They're gonna stop that league.
Yeah, it's gonna be fucking scary. I mean, there's gonna be some veggies, or you know, some bad situations. Cause
the scary ones to me are like some of those pro wrestlers who end up getting into pills, like Chris Benoit, who ends up murdering his whole family and like killing himself. And just like, just one day, his brain just fucking flipped on him. You're just like, God, yeah. That's terrifying.
Yeah, that was pretty severe. I mean, fuck yeah, you do think like those wrestlers must have got a ton. Shit ton, living the life they did and what they did just to go out there every night and fucking...
Especially them old boys traveling fucking two shows a night, like just crazy hours.
In front of fucking, you know, 400 people some nights, just, you know, trying to make a buck or a dime. And, you know, then obviously addictions of drugs and alcohol, fucking...
Yep.
You're basically like a rock star. I mean, you're out there
fucking... Oh, yeah.
But you know, you have to go out there and be physical. I mean, wrestling... It's not a day off, fucker. I mean, that's pretty physical shit. So, I don't know how they did that. That's a hard life to live.
Do you think that you would not do it if you look back on it now? I mean, 87 fights. That's a lot of fights, man. And just, I mean, some nights, like some, there was a year where you're fighting Steve McIntyre, then Fedoric, then Mazur, and like 1 year. It's like, do you ever go back and go, fuck, I should have done something else, or is it? You know, you loved it so much, you were good at it, and it's like, you can't really think that way.
Yeah, I mean, that's how I made the team. I fucking broke Joe Bouvier's nose bleeding everywhere, fucking home opener. And I was like, you know, that's what you're going to do pretty much. I mean, I fought in Bantam once, and then Triple A Midget, we had a pretty tough team. We fought a couple times. I had Justin Jack on my team, which is an absolute meathead, like just crazy goofy guy. But tough, but yeah, I mean, he's getting the role, and you don't think, oh, fuck, I wish I would have fought more. At that time in the year, I mean, fucking should have threw down even more to get more attention.
Yeah.
But, yeah, thinking back on it, I wouldn't change it. Fuck, I can barely watch hockey now. Not that I don't love the sport itself and everything that goes involved with it, but it's missing something a bit that, who was it? Tortorella said it's missing that hate kind of, that intensity.
Yep.
And some nights, you know, I find myself even on the radio, just like, where the hell is that? Like, how do you not just lose it on someone out there just fucking want to fight?
Yeah, yeah. Or, you know, you would be notorious for crushing a dude, you know, laying out a clean hit and then just having that smile on your face. Like, where it's just gone, man.
Yeah, I mean, and it's fucking like soccer on skates. I mean, the breakouts, it's like yep. Set up. We'll let you do this, pass it to him, and get it on the ice and fucking... If you're running around trying to hit like that, you're going to be out of position now because it's just totally different. It's like fucking kick back, they pass to the forward, kick it back to the D. He comes through the neutral zone, fucking finds a lane, a gap, puts the puck in. And now, fuck, if you do hit someone, you're going to get fined or suspended for fucking 20 games. And I get the whole head. I watch football, fucking watching the quarterbacks. You can't touch a quarterback. If I was an offensive lineman or linebacker, fuck, I'd just be like, I wouldn't even touch a quarterback. Fucking
no, I just drop back in pass coverage. Fuck it.
Yeah, I'm going to wave my hands real high, hopefully fucking get a deflection, disrupt your view, but I can't hit you because I'm going to get a fucking flag for it no matter what. So here you go, fucking throw the ball down the field. Let's just have all the offense and the pretty boys get the glory.
Yeah, I find myself, you know, torn sometimes because I'm such a big fan of you guys and the fighters and stuff, but then I hear, like, you know, how some of the, like, Pete and the guys that aren't doing so well, and I'm like, well, what kind of asshole am I to, you know, like, ask you guys about how you fought and, you know, shit like that, and it puts you in a weird spot, you know, but it's, I think it's also, like you said, it's so important and it was so awesome in hockey's history and the guys that did it well and yeah, even guys that just did it, like, I have an appreciation for it, but it makes me feel weird sometimes when because it does have such a lasting effect, I guess.
Yeah, I know what you're saying. I mean, fucking seeing what's happening, and yeah, the pain is a pretty precious little thing, and you know, you only get one, obviously, in one life, but yeah, you're noodle too. I mean, I got some cognitive memory is really hard, sometimes short term for me, and the depression thing, I think it makes your mood go up and down a little bit more than you would ever want to. With the whole concussion thing, yeah, it's a tough line. I mean, you know, you're out there cheering these boys on, you're looking for that, but then you see kind of what's happened to people. It's hard. I mean, fuck, it's a physical sport with gladiators.
Like, yeah, well, absolutely.
That's, you know, and I think that was a thrill. I mean, a privilege, man. Fuck, I'm glad I grew up on the air where it's fighting and hockey is important. There's a role. And, you know, you're right, though, looking back and you see the shit that's happening and it's kind of, you feel bad about it sometimes, looking for that fighter, just being such a fan of, you know, that element of hockey and fighting.
But, yeah.
I watch football, too. It's like, fuck, I don't even want to play defense because you can't hit a guy coming through the middle. You can't get at the quarterback. It's like, fucking.
It's fun crushing somebody, man. It really is. As fucked up as that is, like, it's fun to be violent. Oh. It just is.
Oh, man, I miss that. Just that, man, oh, man, see a guy in the corner and go fucking light him up and just put him on his ass, or he's in front of the net and you just fucking toss him in that one-on-one. We just own another man on the ice or on the field of play. I mean, it's a feeling that not many people get to do. I know you got to do it playing football, but it's something else. And
how's the high when you're in a hockey fight and you fucking drop a dude? Is there any better feeling on the planet?
Oh no, man. I mean, sometimes it doesn't happen often. Obviously, in a couple, fucking one got me called up there and fought Thompson, Brett Thompson, in Oklahoma City, and fucking dropped him, and fucking, you know, I did the old knockout, like, referee thing. You know? I don't know. That just came to me. I never planned anything like that, but it just fucking came to me. And, oh, man, what a rush. Fucking 10,000 rednecks in Oklahoma City just going crazy. I get out there my next shift, and fucking who comes at me is best friend Phil Crow. And fucking you're fighting Phil Crow in the same period, same game.
Yeah, you know, yeah.
Tossing. The fucking funny thing is, Phil Crow was here in Colorado. I lived with him for fucking 2 weeks at his house. He brought me in and he ended up coaching me my second year here. He was a defenseman coach, so.
No shit.
Oh, yeah. Crozy's a good dude. And he's still out here in Colorado doing really well with the oil and gas thing, directional drilling. He's got a good setup. But, yeah, it's funny. I mean, you fight guys and you go out like, fuck, Millett. I remember in Youngstown I fought him. And that night we're going out for beers after, you know, after the game. Hey, you know, it's a part of the game, and I miss it truly. But yeah, like you said, it's kind of hard sometimes when you're cheering that on and you're a big fan of it, and you see some of the boys that are struggling with it and what's happened to them with their lives after hockey.
Yeah, yeah, it really is, man. And you know, we've brought up Oklahoma a few times. That was something I wanted to specifically ask you about. Playing in Oklahoma, because you think of like hockey markets and you know, traditional cities. How was the culture in Oklahoma City when you were playing hockey there?
Oh, crazy. Fuck, they're all OU or OSU. Like, I've never seen football crazy people in my life like that. Just college. And that's all they had, really, was the college football. They didn't have any pro sports. Like, we were the only pro sports there. And fuck, dude, they're unbelievable. Like, I played on Christmas Day, and I come out, there's 15,000 people in the stands.
Holy shit.
And we had one game against Tulsa, our rival, fucking 25,000 people in the stands, and Oklahoma was a beautiful rink, big, you know, pro rink the basketball team plays on. It's huge, and they accepted. I mean, coming from a farming background and going there, they're all blue collar, obviously pretty hardworking, the Bible Belt a bit, you know, really religious and everything, but good people. But yeah, they didn't know much about hockey.
Nah.
They love the fighting, obviously, so they're down with that. And, you know, obviously made you a popular player out there, but yeah, it's just fucking...
That's what I'd assume, that some of the guys like yourself would be a little more popular there, just because they don't know what the hell's really going on, but they know that. They know a fight. They can get into that.
Yeah, well, you know, minor league hockey, too, everywhere. Some of the teams, you know, where they played at, hockey was not the hotbed thing that they are to do. Like, kids didn't play... They didn't have a huge background in it, but they didn't really know the game. But everyone loves a fight.
Oh, yeah.
Still, I mean, to this day, I mean, it's going to get the biggest roar of the crowd pretty much.
Always.
If you have a nutso game, too, imagine if a line brawl or something like that, the intensity that hate comes out in the game, the fans are losing their minds. And it's a part of hockey, obviously, that's pretty much gone. You don't see it very often. But when it's out there, the fans still love the shit out of it.
Absolutely, man. Absolutely. Now, you have a kind of an uncommon year there after, you know, playing juniors. You went to college for a year. Did you have, a specific thing you wanted to go study? Or is it you didn't know if you wanted to play hockey anymore or didn't get drafted by a team, so you took another year to continue your game?
Yeah, you know, I had some AHL tryouts. Give it to me, and just decided to go to school and try to get my 4-year degree that I paid through the Western Hockey League, which is a pretty nice thing when you play in the juniors. You get a year of school paid for by the team every year you play there. So I had 4 years, and I could have went and got a degree, and fucking was sitting there. I was in management and doing already taking calculus, stats, fuck all these hard classes, micro, macro, economics, and you know, powered through a year and did all right, but at the end of it, I was just fucking, I don't know if I was burnt out in hockey, or I was just like, I didn't want to sit fucking in traffic, too, and go to office, sit there all day either, so I took a year off hockey. It was pretty bad. Was just a professional bouncer, fucking part-time topless waiter, and I played one game of hockey that year with my girlfriend's sister's husband. Went out there and fucking played men's league and just running around and ended up fighting him and fucking getting kicked out. And that was my one game of hockey that year. other than that, I was fucking doorman, just a fucking bouncer living the life, but not a very good life, hanging out with strippers, bikers, fucking criminal elements. It was kind of got in deep with it too bad, and just woke up one morning after crazy ass night, and I fucking just said, I got to get out of here. I want to play hockey again. Fucking phone Kelly McCrimmon, Brandon, awesome fucking dude. Really good guy. And phoned him and said, hey, Kelly, I want to play hockey. And what can you do for me? And he phones Don Hay, who coached at Kamloops when I played in the Wood Dub, but he was coaching. And Don Hay was in Utah with the AAA club for Calgary. And fucking got me a tryout after a year and not playing any hockey at all. And I went down there and played, tried out for him. Fuck, what the shitty thing was, my last day at the bar, I got jumped by a bunch of, believe it was Asians, it sounded like. I was going, fucking put my keys in my vehicle, you know, just heard spattering behind me talking, and fucking got this shit kicked out of me.
What?
Oh, yeah, boots to the ground. There's just a ton of them.
were they in the club or something, or they just...
Oh, no. We had run-ins that year. With them, you know, not allowing him in the club. Some of them just make up rules so they couldn't get in. They were over 25, and there's a big ass standoff outside the bar once. They had fucking tons of people there. But anyways, I don't know what if I pissed one off. Yeah, I was fucking my last day and just fucking took the boots and ended up with a Bruce Sternum. I was at Utah. Fucking could barely breathe, man.
Damn, dude.
Yeah, it was bad. I mean, fucking, it was hard trying to move around out there, but I ended up having a Bruce Stern. Going down there to Utah and less than enough. Fucking some big boys down there got a couple scraps and did all right. And a couple boys from Oklahoma were trying out there too as well. And they told Dougie Sauter, who was coaching in OKC, and they brought me down there, and that's how I ended up down there.
Shit, man, that's crazy.
Yeah, fucking crazy.
That's fucking wild, man.
Well, took a year off hockey, did that, and then played it here in Oklahoma City, did pretty well. Fuck, next year I'm trying out for the Philadelphia Flyers. So,
dude,
it was quite the transformation and change, and pretty lucky. I mean, that was a pretty quick thing from taking a year off hockey and being able to do that and still be involved. But that's when fucking fighting mattered still, man. So
yeah, man.
That's the only reason I got the call up too. I mean, fucking the Phantoms that year fucking got that huge ball with Bridgeport, a big fucking line clearing brawl and fucking had rival. And fuck, back in the AHL was a jungle, man.
Dude,
everyone had fucking 2-3 fucking, like, dude, that's fucking,
look up the fucking Phantoms that were on the team when you played in Philadelphia, dude.
That's a good story. Fucking my first game, fucking Hershey. That was where we were there. Fucking that's the night they barely slept, lined up, and you know I'm looking around the locker room. Fucking PJ Stock, Vandermeer, Pistol Pete Vandermeer, man, that's
yeah,
he's one of the pound for pound toughest guys I played with.
Oh, he's I mean, on that team, I think he probably led the team in PIMS, I would assume.
Oh yeah, and fucking Craig Berube, like fucking. I mean, unbelievable. So the first game, we're in Hershey, and fucking Boyd Kane, kid that played in Regina, our rival. Brandon.
He's a tough son of a bitch, too.
Yeah, he could throw the body, and fuck, we're warming up, and some kid came up to him at the red line, fucking pushed him. So this instinct, you go out there, and I fucking hammered him back. And then, fucking, next thing I know, I'm looking down the barrel of a stick, and who's on the other fucking end? Dennis Bonvie.
That's a fucking nightmare, dude.
Yeah, well, fucking best thing is, you got Craig Berube coming out, get the fuck out of here, you know, like behind you, PJ Stock at your back as well. Fuck, nothing happened, but yeah, it was just an insane, tough team. I mean, like I said, back then, you had to wait in line to get in a fight.
That Peluso was on that team too, I think.
Yeah, it wasn't the tough guy Peluso. You
know, oh, okay, the other Peluso.
That would have been scary. We had fucking.
I was like, holy shit, dude, that would have been a lot.
Yeah, that would have been too much meat, man, for one team. Yeah, we had, I mean, fuck, like I said, it was kind of nice, so you didn't have to fucking go out there every night. We relied on to be a fucking go-to guy, the only, you know, one of the guys that's going to fight. But fuck, that team was full of, that was team toughness, and they could play too. I mean, fucking good players, but guys I idolize, like fucking, you know, look up to Craig Berube growing up and watching his shit he did.
He's a pure beauty. He had some just amazing fights, just dropping. Berube was just, he was something else.
Battle Alberta, all that shit. The funny thing is, fucking first road trip, we get off the bus in Cincinnati, like, Borsheim, here with Berube. I'm like, holy fuck. I remember it was Craig Berube. So we go to the
room. Fuck down!
Oh, yeah. Well, we go out that night, we go to a nice steak, and boys are buying wine, like PJ Stock, and sitting at a table with those boys. Obviously, they're picking up the bill, and they go back to the room that night, and I'm just, like, fucking lying in bed. I'm, like, picking Craig, like, Ruby's brain. I'm like, you fought Dave Brown. How was that? Like, who's the toughest guy? You fought the Battle Alberta, man. That was nuts. Like, fucking, just, like, who's the toughest guy? Why didn't you ever throw a left? He's like, I never had to. Fuck, I just
threw a left. Shit.
But, yeah, he's picking his brain, and fucking finally, he's, like, fucking grabs the road, shuts the TV up. Shut the fuck up, kid. We got a game tomorrow. shut the room down and went to bed. But yeah, fuck, that was a surreal moment when you're rooming with Craig Berube, a guy you looked up to watching the tube, see me, you know, hockey night in Canada, and next thing you know, fucking off a gear, not playing hockey, being a fucking low life, bouncing, you know, topless waiting.
Yeah.
You go to rooming with Craig Berube on the road. It was a pretty cool thing. You know?
And that's in a year's time, dude.
No, it was nuts. It was pretty nuts. Yeah, a year and a bit.
did Vandermeer, you know, Berube give you any kind of hindsight, or was it just like, you know, keep your head up, keep plugging, kid? Or was there any tips back then?
Best fucking piece of advice I got probably in life, and was from Berube. I kind of asked him how you do it, and he's like, never get too low, kid. Never get too high. Just try to stay in that middle plane. And that's fucking. That's hard for anyone in life.
Yeah.
You can just know, not get let your head get too big, but never get too low, and just have that fucking even keel and buzz through every day and every game you play. Like, just be a fucking solid. I mean, that was the best piece of advice Berube gave me. It's just fucking, it's like, stay in the middle, kid. Never get too low, never get too high, but try to stay right in that middle keen, and you'll be all right. But a fucking Pistol Pete Vandermeer, I mean, watching him fight, you just learn.
Yeah.
He was so technical. Fuck, the guy looked like Mr. Burns. He'd be smoking, drinking, but he had no muscle. But fuck, could he fight, man? Just amazing technical fighter. That year, he had fucking 400 pounds fought. I think he led the league almost.
Fucking fought everyone.
Yeah, that year, he was fucking scrapping everyone. He went out there after, obviously, Grattan took me down the first period. Fuck, next period, Pistol Pete was fighting him, so... Yeah, it was a lot of guys to watch. PJ Stock, another guy, obviously, who could fight some fucking classics. Obviously, with Petey, that one will go down in history. Pete and Stocker, and, you know, in Boston, Washington, that was a classic. But yeah, Petey was a good guy, too. And I mean, Stocker, he was good, too, like just giving advice, kind of even fighting after I fought Colton Orr in Providence. Yeah, he was kind of giving me some tips, you know, on what to do in a fight and how to get better.
And fighting a guy like Grattan or Colton Orr, is that like a... Because Colton Orr is a big dude. Is there like a tactic you have to take to get into that? But, I mean, you're not a small dude either. So, is it like, here we go, let's see who has the most meat?
Yeah, fuck, I remember. Well, Colton Orr went fucking at a kid in Providence running around and hitting someone, hitting everyone, like, just being hit. So, I caught him in the neutral zone, fucking clocked him, and... Puck got dumped back down, you know, kind of cycled around, and got put to my back end, and fucking was ended at the end of the shift and extended a bit, you know, a little gas. Then Colton Orr came in, fucking, you know, I knew what was going to happen. It's go time, and fucking Orr's, he can throw both, and obviously he's a big kid. He's not overly big like a monster, but fuck, could he ever fight? Super technical, super tough.
He's long.
Yeah, he can really extend you too. He's got some monkey arms on him, so. Fuck that fight, I was gassed and just trying to hang in there and do my best and go back and forth, and, you know, looking out for the big punch, but just basically trying to get some offense, and didn't last super long, but I definitely, something that fucking, you know, fighters, obviously, in the Orzy, he was kind of throw both hands because he played junior too, and Swift Current, tough kid, and, you know, back then even, like, now I think, well, a little bit ago, you could scout fighters, you go on hockeyfights.com and you watch the fights and, you know, see what they do, fucking, which hockeyfights.com now is pretty much dead because, fuck, there's no fighting in the NHL or, you know, not a whole bunch anywhere.
Yeah, the ones they call fights, the hug and twist.
Oh, fuck, it's a hug fest, man. I love that part. Just, fuck, everyone come and grab someone to hug and talk. And look how a fight's going to happen. Nope, just a fucking hug fest. Everyone grab someone.
The best is when you're watching with, like, a casual fan and they get fucking pumped up because they're, you know, there's a scrum in front of the net. Like, nothing's going to happen. I don't know what you're getting excited about. They're just going to rub each other's gloves on their face.
Yeah, stinky gloves and fucking hug.
I don't even know why you would put it up. Like, it's not even a fight. Just fucking don't even say it is. Just get rid of it.
Yeah, I mean, fucking, it's obviously, like we talked, there's that fine line, and we talked about it with everything that's happened. And brain injuries is a serious thing, but it's just something that's missed, that hate, that intensity. And, you know, fans obviously miss it. They got to. I mean,
yeah.
They appreciate yell and speed. Everything the kids now that they have, fucking, it's way different. I mean, fucking junior hockey, we're drinking beers after a game, and now they're drinking protein shakes. Like, fuck, these kids that come up, the young kids in the AHL of the year are in Brandon now, just fucking, they are way ahead of the game, and they're taking care of themselves and training, and it fucking agents got them just set up for, you know, making them the pros, and it's just a different game, mess.
I'd like to see just a couple kids maybe drink a few more beers and just get a couple of them, you know. They're bettering themselves and everything, and I shouldn't say that, but it's always nice to fucking see a good hockey fight.
Yeah, oh, it's something. Obviously, it's always going to be around. It's going to happen, but just not it's the fast than it was before. The role of enforcer is pretty much dead. It's sad, and makes for me watching hockey a little less fun.
Just the element of it. Like, yeah, could it happen?
Yeah, it could happen. It's going to fucking be a factor, like, in a game. Probably it can switch the momentum and everything. Like, fucking fighting, people don't realize what it did. I mean, it's about momentum, too. I mean, you go out there, your team's fucking playing like shit, and you go out there and challenge their tough guy, whatever. You're just trying to swing things, and if he gives you the okay and the opportunity to fight, you know, get back in the game and change that momentum, that's one element. Obviously, one is just pure hatred, or something happens, you just drop the gloves and shed them, and you're fighting. But yeah, like, people don't get the role and how it worked in hockey, and the element it played, and the policing of the game. You know, missed call by the referee, you could go out there and kind of set the tone and make up for it. But
the personality, I mean, is a huge thing. Listen to a fucking interview with you or Johnny score a bunch of goals. I mean, you can even tell Spit and Chicklets now is only getting old enforcers or guys that used to fight because they know their other interviews are... No one wants to hear Casey Middlestead talk because he's not fucking... he's not interesting.
Yeah, no, I mean, well, and that's another thing, too. Like I touched on the broadcasting, the TV, the radio guys. I mean, fuck, those guys are the nuts and bolts. So much character, obviously, to play that role and do that job. And, you know, But fucking fun-loving guys like fucking Fraser Flippick, the guy I played.
Oh, my God, dude. Fraser Flippick, what a fucking terror.
Oh, he was a nut man on the ice. He put skates on a kid. He used to joke he was raised by wolves. Crazy. Like, the shit he did on the ice, like, I was just like, fucking Flippy, really? Like, eye gouging. Fuck, he didn't care. Like, fucking spearing, shooting a puck at a kid in the head. Like, dumping a puck in.
Damn.
Meaning to put him off his lid, like shooting it at his head on dump it. Like, fucking, he did that to a kid, caught him, dropped him, like a rat on another team, and get back to the bench. I'm like, Flip, you mean to do that? He's like, oh, yeah, Borch. I feel good, huh? That shot? Flip, you had a list.
Oh, did he?
Oh, but dude, off the ice, the nicest dude. First one, he hugs my parents, every friend I have. Fucking nice dude. Still a really good friend, like, after my injury and everything, fucking. He's been supportive. We go out to eat, and he'll be like, fucking, like, in the first, my hands were so tight, he'd be stretching my fingers, we'd be out eating.
Well, sweetheart.
Or whatever. And I'm like, fucking, Flip, you know we're pretty fucking gay right now. He's like, fuck, Borch, I don't care.
Say, I dare someone to say something to him.
Oh, yeah, I know. But he got some tilts off the ice, probably. He's got some crazy stories, but for the most part, he is the nicest dude off the ice, and that's usually how it works with that role. And out, you know, tough guys that you know, always think they're going to be like this idiot or meathead kind of type. And I'm not going to lie, there are some that are like that and are probably hard to hold a conversation with them because they do have a mentality. But for the most part, man, they're educated. Like, Flippy is the most vast, useless knowledge. Like, he knows more about history, the war, and everything. Like, but fuck, so funny, like, so comedy. Like, since life, I always say if I have to bring someone to a fox, so definitely bring Fraser Flippy just for his vast knowledge, useless knowledge, and just his comedy. Like, he's fucking funny kid as hell, but scary on the ice. Some of the shit he did, I was just like,
oof.
You're gonna get fucking arrested, man, for that shit. Like, that's not legit.
Yeah, he's gonna get assault charges, dude. He was, he's the Eagles' leading in pims of all time, I'm pretty sure.
Yeah, well, we had great Pankwitz, too.
Oh, Pankwitz, oh my God, dude.
He was nuts. He'd either get three goals or fucking 20 minutes in pill. He was another guy that shoot on the ice, too. That was just like, holy shit. Like, him and a guy go down after a fight, and you just see the fucking linesman trying to break it up. And the other guy's legs just squirming, like, fucking trying to get out of there. Because Panky was probably trying to eye gouge, fish hook him, or doing something to him.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
he was fucking crazy, but crazy good, too. Like, fuck, he could play. Score goals, and he was money and clutch for us a lot of the time, but yeah, he didn't lose his mind. Fucking tomahawk chops and just violent man.
Yeah, violent dudes, but a talented team too you guys had.
Yeah, I mean, we fucking went to championships fucking, I think, 2 to 3 years I was here. All three. We lost in the seven the 1 year in the finals.
Yeah, lost in the finals and then won in the year before, right?
Yeah, so yeah, it's fucking, We had skill. I mean, I look back at the thing. There's me, Flippy. I led the league, and there's Flippy and Pankowitz, top five penalty minutes. But then there's Panky, who's fucking top 10 scoring. You know, we had tons of talent. Team toughest, Ryan Tobler.
Tobler, man. I was going to say, he was a bad motherfucker, too.
Oh, he's a big boy, big German boy. He could fucking throw mitts good, real good fighter. But fuck you, you put him in the front of the net. Really skilled guy. You know, could play hockey and obviously has a mind for it. He's a fucking assistant coach right now for the Eagles at the AHL level. So, really hockey smart guy, but another guy who could fight. So,
well, it seems like you guys had a good family. Like, a lot of you guys are sticking around there.
Yeah, there's a few of the boys are. I mean, around here, my defenseman partner, Brad Williamson, and it's an awesome community. I mean, here in Colorado and where we're at and the support, I mean, fucking for me with my injury after what's happened, it's been unbelievable. It's a huge blessing. And yeah, it's hard for some of the boys to leave. You know, we get stuck down here and it's a good situation, beautiful weather and a great state, obviously Colorado, and the economy and everything, 420 friendly.
Fucking booming out there now.
The green rush. Yeah, it's pretty crazy. Good spot to be, but yeah, quite a few of the boys do stick around. They find life after hockey and some pretty sweet jobs out here in Colorado and stick around.
That last year, or the 06-07, you guys go to the finals. You say you led in PIMS and you still had a plus 24, dude.
Oh, fuck. I don't know if that was that was my first year here in Colorado. I led PIMS. I had like 340.
Okay, the first, yeah.
Yeah, and then the second year, I fucking kind of got my shit together. Kind of got on the wagon, sobered up, and then had a career year that year, fucking playing forward defense, you know, my role as enforcer.
Still at 229.
Yeah, it lightened up a bit, but yeah, it was a good year, and fucking really had a great year career-wise, obviously points, and then win a championship, you know, whatever level it's at, AA, AAA, and obviously Stanley Cup, but whenever you're holding that cup above your head after a year, fucking, it was pretty unbelievable. Fuck, that year we won, I had a broken finger, I had a hairline fracture in my hip, and then ended up having a sports hernia because I was getting shot up to play because of my hip. Ended up tearing my muscle in my abdomen and getting a sports hernia. Just shit beat out of you. I mean, we played fucking 25 games, I think, in 50 days that playoffs when we won that championship. So it was hockey every other day and the travel, fuck, go to Laredo and fucking, well, we actually ended up flying instead of busing it, thank God. But, I mean, you hold that cup over your head. It feels like the Stanley Cup because you're with your boys.
Oh, fuck yeah. Well, it's your Stanley Cup for sure.
Yeah, you play that long of a season. The bonds you build, fucking, you won't forget it. I definitely, you know, pretty tight with a lot of the boys on that squad when we won the championship. You're right. Like, fuck, it don't matter. You win the Holy Grail. That's your goal. Every hockey team you're on is to be winning and holding that championship above your head, no matter what league it's in. It feels like pure gold and glory. So yeah, that was my best year of my life.
That was the President's Cup, right? The Ray Mirren?
Yeah, that was the President's Cup at the time, Ray Mirren. Not sure who he is, but obviously big deal minor league hockey, his name on the cup. But yeah, fucking fun times and definitely a tight bond with those boys still.
Well, dude, that last year too, I mean, you had the most points you ever had in your final season, 22 points, but that playoffs, the year you guys lost in the finals, ended up almost getting 70 PIMS in just the playoffs in 16 games, dude. You went ham-bone those playoffs.
Oh, well, fuck yeah. And then right before the finals, we played Fort Wayne and had a big fucking end of the game. Well, no, it was two games before the finals started. End of the game, fucking line brawl, like fucking full-out brawl, everyone on the ice, like fucking, almost ended up fighting the fucking coach for Fort Wayne. I was right this on the bench, like, so Pankowitz got suspended, another guy got suspended for the finals, so we're missing some elements in the finals, no excuses, but fuck yeah. You know, obviously, you watch, even in the NHL, the physical part of hockey gets ramped up in playoffs a bit.
Yeah.
Actually out there fucking finishing a check once in a while, and you know, so yeah, fucking, you still got to play that role of defend, and it, you know, obviously it's all about winning, but fucking back then fighting and enforcing and defending and sending a tone and sending a message was a big part of winning a hockey game. So yeah, the PIMS added up.
Well, yeah, people were probably like, oh, you know, Les is kind of taking it easier this year, you know, 150
But then playoffs come around, you're just fucking just dominating, dudes.
No, listen, I'm out fucking last year, too. And I played a little forward, too, a defense. I didn't know what to be playing to come to the rink and fucking see my name up there as a forward. And I'm like, oh, fuck, great. Just can run around, don't think about it a whole bunch, just hit anything that moves and fucking try to, you know, hopefully have one bounce in off me or fucking get a couple shots on that. But, yeah, it was a good time here. Colorado's a beautiful place, and it's fun to play.
Absolutely, man. Two dudes I wanted to ask you about from the Dub when you were there is, you know, I know you like to have a few beers here and there, and I know Jordan Tutu was back then. Did you have a good time? Was he there your last year when you were there?
Yeah, Toots was there my last year. Fucking pretty crazy story. His rise to glory and where he came from, fucking not even playing like organized hockey when he was fucking 10. I don't know when it started, like really late.
Right.
In his life, and then he came to Brandon, yeah, fucking great kid, and fucking just jacked and chiseled, like huge, just stocky kid, fucking.
Yeah, he's the definition of stocky.
Oh, hardest hit I think I've seen was he hit Steve McIntyre for the Blades, and fucking Toots is so small compared to Big Mac. Like, Diesel fucking hammered him, like, got him off his skates. Mac's fucking helmet flies off his stick, flew in the stands, like, just one of those hits where he just caught him, but Toots would fucking skate, and then he'd hit. He'd be like, there's no gliding. He was moving his feet, fucking, you know, kind of laying into you. And, you know, he was a pretty good kid that year. Rookie party, we, you know, fucking for Brandon that year, almost killed him. We're driving around, you know, probably shouldn't have been, and fucking almost went off a cliff. Ended up, you know, crashing in a ditch and then having to fucking find a ride to rookie party. But, he is a good kid, and I know I ran into him in Milwaukee at camp trying out for them after I was in Philadelphia the lockout year, and he was in Milwaukee and a draft pick for Nashville. He was tearing it up pretty good. You know, he had some stories, and he was living it up. And,
yeah.
Really proud of the kid and how he's doing now and what he's doing, what he's all about, you know. He played hard, and he had that mentality out there. Playing hockey, and sometimes hard to separate that from off ice as well.
Yep.
Usually a lot of us guys that play like that and play that role sometimes get you know, trapped into that lifestyle or kind of mentality when you're off the ice. And fucking for what he's done, turn around, I'm so proud of him. And he had quite the life, quite the story, and now the platform he has because of that and how he's using it, fucking it's good on him what he's doing.
Yeah, he's awesome. And there's a dude that I wasn't really familiar with, and I've been on Fourth Line Voice on his YouTube pretty much last 3 days watching Randy Ponte videos.
Oh, fuck.
Oh, my God, dude.
He ended up being like fucking, like, I'm a farm kid from Saskatchewan. We got him out of Juvie. Like, he came straight out of Juvie.
What was he in Juvie for?
He punched a kid, fucking busted his ear so he couldn't hear, fucking cracked his head pretty good in a fight, so he got sent to Juvie. So we get this kid, fucking 16 years old, like, just a thug from Burnaby, like, fucking baggy pants, like, complete opposite of, you know, a farm kid from Saskatchewan, but fuck, we ended up having a pretty tight bond, and he ended up being my good buddy in Brandon. But yeah, what a beauty, man. That kid could fight, he'd fight anyone. I mean, he wasn't always squaring off legally either. He liked to jump the odd guy and played the game hard and dirty, but fuck,
He ended up playing in that fucking Super Fight League, too.
Was he out there?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I think he played out there for a couple years. I'm not 100%, but I think so, man.
Yeah, no, fucking, he was a beauty, man. Like, we bonded, had a lot of beer, smoked, you know, a little bit of bud away from the ice, and, you know, had our fun in Brandon. But yeah, fucking kid was ruthless on the ice, and just fucking loved how he didn't back down from no matter how big the kid was. He had this mentality. He was the toughest fucker on the ice, and he played like it. And he was a fun kid to play with. And fucking, I think he set a record. Well, no, Toporowski's got the Dub record, I think, for Pims, but all time, Randy Ponte is up there, like fucking top three, I think, for Pims during his career.
Dude, he's been blowing my mind the last few days. He's one of them dudes. Like I said, there's different sections of an enforcer, and he's definitely one of them guys that likes to fucking fight.
Yeah, he enjoyed it. He is a thug kid from Burnaby, BC. You know, big fucking chain, baggy pants. you wouldn't think we would bond that tightly, but maybe because of the role or the type of personalities we had, fuck, we hung out all the time.
Just two animals, dude.
Oh yeah, fuck, he was fun. We had some good times in Brandon, tore that city apart.
I've just got a few more for you, man, if that's all right.
Oh, that's good.
Cool, man. You've actually gone tilted with a couple guys that have been on the show before, Riley Cote and Cam Jansen. Do you remember those fights?
Yeah, fucking Jenny was in Philadelphia, New Jersey game. We played a little exhibition or whatever in camp, and fucking warm-up Jansen's barking at the blue line. I'm like, who the fuck is this guy? And why is he barking? What is this shit? So yeah, then he came down and fucking... I was just in front of the net, pushing back and forth. And he was barking again, so we fucking tossed down, fought. It was a pretty quick fight. I think it was like fucking 15 seconds, throwing punches back and forth. He was a super young kid that I didn't even know about. He was rapping everything he had. And I fucking had a good tilt with him, obviously. And Coates fucking was Memphis. And I just remember that one. Came down, pinched on
him. Oh, yeah, that was when you were in Oklahoma, wasn't it?
Yeah, it pinched down on him, fucking hit him, and fucking ended up tossing. I remember fucking hearing rumor about Cote that he's got plastic in his hand or metal or something in his fucking hand from the days of PA. but yeah, fucking had a good tilt with him, and good to see, man, fucking what he's doing with his platform.
Yeah, he's killing it, man.
Ah, it's a smart move. I mean, fucking, I'm like that the NHL is kind of starting to accept it as well. I mean, more open-minded than any other fucking professional sports to the fact that marijuana and hemp and what it can do, medically and its purpose and how it's helpful. He's ran with it. And, it's good on him too for using that. And, you know, his knowledge and everything he's bringing to the forefront with its benefits that it does actually have. Fuck, Canada's fucking now.
It's fucking legal. So why wouldn't the NHL embrace it?
Yeah, you know, in their states, it's a fine line, it's a hard line, too. It's weird, you know, it's illegal here in Colorado, and people will get busted, you know, at jobs because they'll, you know, piss hot or whatever for it. But then it's like, well, it's fucking legal in the state, so how can you fire someone or not hire them because, you know, they're pissing hot for marijuana?
Yeah, so that's weird.
It's something we need to figure out. I think you got to realize that, you know, prohibition of alcohol before, like, fuck, we didn't have booze. You know, before, so it's something I think eventually it's going to be nationwide and something that we got to wake up to, you know, maybe and fucking throw off our blinders to the benefits and how bad it actually is. I mean, fuck, it's marijuana, like, obviously it slows you down a bit, maybe reaction time, possibly when you're dry, I don't know, but there's just too many medical benefits. And
it's too beneficial. The pros outweigh the cons completely.
You know, what are the cons? I mean, maybe lung cancer and stuff like that. I mean, laziness, I'm not sure.
Shit, there's some stuff you'll eat and you'll be fucking running a marathon.
Oh, yeah, to get the sativa in that thing, and you could, high sativa will get you going.
Oh, yeah, man. And I think Cote, too, that was a hard decision, you know, when he was at Lehigh. It was like, all right, you can't keep repping this, you know, this hemp and continue to be a coach. And that was probably really hard decision to make, and it definitely was the right one for him.
Yeah, you know, I bet you that was either or kind of thing, for him to have to do and realize. But yeah, that's the other thing you see, fucking all the meatheads and fighters that end up being coaches too as well, like fucking Buchner and fucking Florida, like all these guys who go on, and Tim Hunter fucking leading the, you know, the world juniors. Obviously he had some hockey sense and smarts in him, you know, as he played the game, but yeah, I'm glad that what Coach did with his platform, obviously having that name, and yeah, probably was a either or decision for him, doing the coaching and then, you know, doing that at the same time. I don't know how that would have rocked and rolled in the hockey world, you know, in that position. But he's doing well, and I think it's something that's a positive. I mean, you know, what he's doing in for hockey, and hopefully the long run, it's going to be something that's going to be used to help out, you know, medically with hockey players and the people throughout the world. Something that he's doing, I'm glad he's doing it.
Oh, yeah, dude, from little kids that have seizures to old people that have arthritis, it's everything in between. It's nonsense not to at least consider it.
Yeah, no, we're fucking, you know, we got to throw some of our old ways away, obviously.
Yeah, if they got to go.
We got to move on and get with it. And if it's a positive, you know, even like, I guess, not to get religious, but that's part of it too. I mean, religious beliefs and everything and the Constitution, all that, you know, not to get political either, but it's something that we got to throw our blinders off and wake up and realize, like you said, the pros to the cons, like, fucking how many cons, how many times you see a pothead or someone smoke too much weed, beat the shit out of their wife or
right.
I'm stupid like that. I mean, it just doesn't happen. And the stigma with it, you know, the fall of smoking weed, this is something that's not true. And if you've done it, you realize what it can do. For me, with my spasms, I shake, got these violent spasms, just shake uncontrollably. It looks like it's, I'm having a convulsion seizure, you know, and I deal with them all day long, but it's a blessing too because it kept my muscle tone and my muscles strong. But fucking yeah, they hurt, they're uncomfortable, make life a little bit miserable. But one thing that does help it is marijuana.
Well, that's good to know, man. Because I've seen the videos, you know, of you having the tremors or whatever, and
yeah.
I didn't know if those hurt or not. But that's good that there can be a pain relief that's not gonna get you addicted and make you some fucking pilled out monster.
Yeah, no, it's definitely, that's another thing too. If I could listen to Cam Jansen's podcast, I think it was on the Biscuit maybe or something, and he was talking about how, you know, they grabbed him pretty good and the pain medication, and he got in the grasp of that. So, you know, if it's something he would have had, maybe I thought of back in the day, maybe he wouldn't have to deal with that. And fucking the Bougard story, obviously.
Yeah.
I mean, it's an element, man, and I can lie still, too. You know, I have to take some pain medication as well, and it's something that can grab a hold of you if you don't watch it. It can take over your life, so definitely have that medical marijuana, and that compared to the pros and cons of that compared to pain medication, what we're seeing, the epidemic in America, fuck, it's kind of a wake-up call on why not, you know, like, this could eventually be nationwide, too.
For sure. The big thing, I think, is everybody that had, you know, experimented with it and at least tried it are becoming people in places that can actually make it legal.
Right.
Because I don't think my grandma would know what a hemp plant looked like if it was growing in her house.
No.
You know what
no.
I mean?
Yeah, no. Wouldn't know the difference.
Now, I mean, you know, I asked you about Cote and Jansen, and you got Bougard on your fight card. I mean, you really got some feathers in the cap, man. And I really appreciate your time and you coming on here. And I appreciate you, you know, continuing on, man. I'm a big fan, and I'm glad that you're doing well and trucking on. And are you guys still doing the golf tournament to help out with some of the medical bills?
Yeah, every year we have the Team Borsheim golf tournament out here in Windsor, and get some Avalanche boys, some local celebrities to come out and help out and golf in it as well. And all the money from that goes to pay for my therapy, which is not covered by insurance, unfortunately.
It's got
to
be expensive, too.
Yeah, it's fucking like $1,000 tops or, you know, bottom to go down there a month to do that. So that just adds up, obviously. So that money goes to generate from that golf tour and goes down there to help me pay for that and continue to be healthy and get stronger and get, you know, the small things back in life to help me live a little bit more independent life. Obviously, I have to live with the fact that I do need help. I have to ask to have help, and that's going to be part of my life probably until they find some medical miracle or whatever it is to, you know, help change SCI and spinal cord injuries. But what I'm doing definitely is putting me in line. If that happens, I'm going to be first in that line to get that help. So what I'm doing, being involved with hockey still as well, fuck, man, that's one thing I realize how blessed I am. That's what I tell people do in my speech, fucking, I wouldn't wish this injury on my worst enemy. Like, fuck, it's gnarly, it's nasty, having everything taken away from you. But I wish, you know, everyone I love, my family, everyone I care about could live one day in my life in this terror to see how fucking lucky and blessed and all the support you actually do have in your life. Because, fuck, you know, I might be a little bit more lucky than the next person with support and everything they have, but we all really do when it comes down to it. So it goes down, you're backed into a corner. There are people that can come out and help you out, support you, and you know, there's a lot of good of people in people. And I've been woken up to that eye opener with his injury and seeing that in the human race and my friends, family, people who care about you, fan base, like, it was an eye opener. I wish everybody could realize that and see that.
Do you keep a GoFundMe open or anything like that where people could donate if they're not able to make it to the golf tournament?
I got a non-profit account set up where people can donate. I can share I don't know the link exactly. I'd have to send that one to you.
Yeah, just send it to me. I'll put it on the internet, man, and send it my way, because I'm sure there's people listening that would like to help out, and that way they can at least get in touch and, you know, maybe monetarily help you out, man. Because I know them bills can stack up, dude.
Yeah, no, I'm definitely blessed to have some fucking... The day of my injury, fucking, I had no insurance. My insurance ran down 5 days before my accident because, do you even think we had a big-ass tornado come here through here, Windsor, and fucking tear this community apart pretty bad. So we're out there helping out, cleaning up everything, and it's like fucking... Didn't even think about it. It was the first nice day before after that. All went down, so I went out for a rip on a bike, you know, a rip on a Harley, and fucking whatever happened transpired. But yeah, I had no insurance to pay for bills, so whatever. Jesus. I saved up during my career kind of fucking you know, went to pay for my medical bills. Fucking no, I'm blessed. The support I have and what I get is absolutely amazing, and you know, something I hope everyone would receive, but I know I'm blessed by what I get here in Colorado.
Fuck yeah, man. Last question, dude. Were you really a stripper?
Oh, God. Fuck, I hope my mom's not listening. No, times are tough, man. I wasn't playing hockey, like I said, and I was a doorman. Started topless waiting at Pure Platinum Nights at the Whiskey in Calgary, and you start meeting friends in the industry, and
one thing leads to another.
Yeah, you gotta do things to, you know. Fuck, I was working construction too, a job at the time, so it was easy.
Easy costume.
Cost to come up with, and you know, like I said, it was probably fucking rock bottom. Like I said, I woke up one night after a crazy ass night of shenanigans and shit, and I'm like, I gotta change my life. I gotta get out of here. But you know, fucking had to do what I had to do.
It's a good story to have now, man.
Oh, yeah. I wasn't even a good dancer at all. I probably had square wheels as well in the bar. I mean, my wheels weren't that good as well, but I was fucking 240 pounds at the time and jacked up and chiseled and working hard. So I had the body for it, but the mentality, man, I just fucking, I think about it now and I fucking get those shivers where I'm just like, oh, fuck, was that? What the fuck? What the fuck was I doing,
dude? Well, if Mama Borsheim's listening, that's not a real story. He's just joking.
Yeah, I'm just going to tell her not to listen to this fucking thing, honestly.
So cut it off around an hour. Just cut her off.
Well, are we going to talk any metal or no metal music or band? You got a band, right?
Oh, fuck yeah. Artillery Breath, man. Been playing in that band for... since 2007, dude. I know you're a heavy metal dude. We know we talked about the Deftones. What are you jamming now?
Oh, fuck now, man. Anything, man. I mean, some of the old shit, Slayer, fucking Sepultura. Fuck, I like the new shit too as well. You know, Deftones, obviously, fucking singer's unbelievable.
Oh yeah, he's a freak.
Fucking, but yeah, fucking, I love it, man. It just speaks to me. Like, fucking, I had a. Fell backwards in my chair, fucking trying to go up a sidewalk with one of my CNAs who helped me out. Cracked my head real good, fucking blood coming down the back of my head. Fucking probably another concussion because I fucking got that smell in your nose kind of when you get hit hard. And you kind of know, like, fucking came back home and get my home and what if I butter? Just fucking pure metal.
Hell yeah, dude.
My CNA is just looking at me and I'm like, it calms me down.
That's dude, I say that same thing and people think it's so weird. I'm like, well, it does something in my brain that makes it relaxed.
Yeah. I mean, obviously it's a different gene we got, right?
Yeah, like, for sure.
It does the same thing to me, man. I just love it. Fucking, and yeah, fucking guitar was a good release too. Get away to that creative element, especially when you're, like I said, in the WHL, you're a young kid, fucking, you know, you're lining up some big boys coming to town and sometimes you just need to get away and escape and fuck the guitar, and jamming with my billets is one good way to get away from a from the stress of hockey and maybe playing that role as well.
Well, that's another thing too, is, you know, there's gonna, your fights are always gonna be online, and Slayer's always gonna be Slayer. It's kind of coincides that even no matter what's gonna happen with the new school and you know, new heavy metal or new hockey, there's always going to be, you know, I can always put on Seasons in the Abyss and have my coffee in the morning. And, you know, my kids, you know, they know all that shit. They're down with Sepultura, like you said. They get into Morbid Angel. I mean, my son will listen to fucking extreme death metal from across the world. And, like, it's just normal for him because he's always heard it, you know what I mean?
Yeah, Sepultura, Roots song, fucking when that bass line drops.
Have you heard their new one?
No.
It is fucking great. I was kind of nervous because they got a little weird there for a while. Or maybe it's the new Soulfly. That's what it is.
Yeah, Soulfly. Let's do Eye for an Eye. Fucking, yeah.
Listen to the new Soulfly tonight, dude. There's a song that opens up with Navajo tribal singers, and it fucking rips, dude.
Yeah, no, fucking love that music. It hits home, man. It gets me going at the same time. Like I said, it's meditation for me, but fuck, if I want to get going, obviously it's going to be metal on the way to the rink, you know, fucking in the parking lot in my headphones. If I didn't fucking wear headphones in the arena like they do now, but if I did, it would have been fucking pure metal blaring through loud. And yeah, it's fucking, man, it's good. You play lead guitar rhythm?
I do the vocals in the band.
Oh, fucking A.
Yeah, buddy. I fuck around on the guitar at home, but like I call that dad guitar. But yeah, I do I do the vocals in the band, and I always liked performing. That was my favorite part of
it. Well, let's hear him rip. Let's hear him rip one time. You got anything for me?
Oh, my vocals? My singing?
Yeah, let's hear it.
No, dude, it's not really singing. It sounds just like some fucking demented dudes growling in a studio.
Yeah, well, I hate that too. Some of these fucking bands have that mic that changes into that growl now.
Oh yeah, that's bullshit, dude.
You know what I mean?
We'd go into certain studios and be like, well, what effect do you want on your vocals? I'm like, none. I don't want any. I said, just hand me a fucking beer and watch me go.
Yeah, let me rip fucking in here. I heard it's not even that hard on the vocals, or as hard on the vocals, like when you're fucking screaming like that.
It's like any fucking muscle, dude. It gets used to it. The first couple days on tour, you might not want to talk as much, or like, not smoke so many fucking darts, but by the end of it, dude, it doesn't even matter. Like it gets so used to it that as long as you can keep your throat like wet, if that makes sense, it's usually pretty fine.
Yeah, well, one fucking band I actually got into, it's not, you know, it's a new fucking Slipknot. I mean, fucking
love Slipknot.
Blatant Bleed always spoke to me when I was in the gym playing hockey, but fucking Corey Taylor, man, he's got some licks and he can sing too. Fuck,
that's always the shit I wish I could do. I could never sing like that, so I'm like, well, I can fucking perform and I can write really well, so I'm gonna do what I can to the best of my ability.
Yeah, look at the fucking size of his neck too, man. From this fucking, hey man, he's got a big ass neck. Like fucking right now I got like 18 and a half neck, three quarter. I can't find fucking dress shirts to fit me because I'm fucking working out. I got a fucking 20-pound head. I got to roll every day and keep up. So that's part of my workout. It's fucking, but my neck's just blowing up. But yeah, fucking Corey Taylor, you see his neck, man, fucking the size of his body.
I see dudes that can top, like, button their top button. I don't know, how the fuck do you do that? Like, that's, I would die.
Yeah, no, I bet you got a fucking pretty big neck. But yeah, fucking Slipknot's one band I like that's a little bit newer, maybe.
Yeah,
the old, you know, the old fucking boys, classic guys like the metal that, you know, rip, that did, might not like Slipknot, but fuck, man.
Did you see the guitar player from Cannibal Corpse get arrested in Florida recently?
For what?
Dude, he lit his house on fire after, like, trying to break into his neighbor's house, like, talking, like, end of the world shit. They find, like, oodles and oodles of guns. Oodles of guns, just ammo fucking everywhere. They find human bones in his house, which I doubt he killed anybody, but I bet he got them on tour, like in fucking South America and shit.
Yeah.
But, and like some illegal guns, most of them were legal, but he is off the fucking rocker, dude. But it's Florida, dude.
Yeah, fucking shit happens in Florida.
It's Florida.
That's not even crazy in Florida.
No, that was just a normal fucking Wednesday afternoon.
Yeah. that's your average neighbor probably in Florida fucking holding that shit in their house.
Oh, the cops come and then he attacks the cop and tries to stab the cop. That's where it got, I mean, not, that's not where it got weird. Obviously, the whole thing's weird, but he had a fucking mental breakdown, man.
Yeah, fucking, I mean, that lifestyle, too, I don't know how, I mean, you hit the road, obviously, fucking, in tour, and that's another thing, fuck, that's what I was rolling. If you weren't a hockey player, they'd ask you in the program what you'd be, like, I want to be a fucking rock star.
Yeah.
That lifestyle, and you guys in the bus, and just night to night, fucking partying. And
it's our locker room, man.
I mean, will you read, like, fucking Aerosmith or some of the books? Like, The Telltale, the fucking Motley Crue? Like,
yeah, Motley Crue is amazing.
How the fuck, first off, are they still alive and did they survive all that? And my other thing is, how the fuck did they get up and play every night? Like, fucking, like, I just be like, fucking, one night, I just be like, fucking, I'm not doing this. Like, I can't, I'm fucking too hungover, strung out on whatever.
Well, and the thing with on tour, too, you get to the city or whatever. If it's, like, an eight-hour drive, that's not the whole day. You don't play till night. So you're just fucking crushing beers and killing time, like, walking around the city you're in. So by nighttime, you're feeling pretty good, and then you just repeat it. Like, there's nothing really to do.
Yeah, it takes a toll, crazy lifestyle, but fuck.
Oh, you get home and lay down in your own bed, and you're like, I'm sure it's like an ending of hockey season. You're just like, holy fuck, what did I just do?
Yeah, oh man, fuck. But that would be so much fun. I love that. I mean, the connection you'd have on stage with fucking people. I mean,
that's the best.
Playing music like that, you look out, fucking, even if fucking it isn't that many people, whatever it is, you're playing your own music, you're playing music, shredding, fucking ripping vocals, fucking, that would be one rush for me, and fucking, it's different than playing hockey, obviously, hockey's pretty physical and all that, but the creativeness and fucking making that connection, just blaring your shit out, fuck, man, that's one thing I wish I could have done, been a rock star, fuck, if I come back, when I do, gonna be a rock star.
We'll switch in the afterlife, dude. I'll go play hockey, you go fucking
Well, you played football too, you know what it's about as well, but fucking jamming like that and being creative and playing in a band, fucking it's a different connection. It's a spiritual one. It's got to be fun.
I'll send you some tracks tonight when we get out of here and see what you think. I bet you'll like it.
Perfect, man. Let them rip. I'll fucking got a good sound system here at home. So
absolutely, man. Well, again, Les, dude, I fucking appreciate you, man. I'm a big fan. I'm glad you're doing well. Tell everybody where they can find you. I know you're on Twitter and Instagram. What are your handles over there?
Oh, fuck. I didn't even know. I think it's Borsh33 on Instagram, and then Twitter is Bobby Borsheim. At Bobby Borsheim, fucking, which I got a name Bobby from our captain, Greg Pankowitz, fucking, it came to Colorado and ended up scoring some goals in preseason, and fuck, he comes in after the game, we're all sitting around, and I'm happy after a victory. He stands up, who the fuck do you think you are, Bobby Orr? and it just stuck here.
That's funny shit, dude.
people start calling me Bobby, so Bobby, that handle stuck. So yeah, Bobby Borsheim on Twitter and then Instagram, I think, is at Borsh33. And then fucking obviously Team Borsheim on Facebook. You can follow me on there and watch some of my trials and tribulations and get some of my training vids up there and my rehab and my recovery and a bit of my story.
Yeah, and all those videos are on YouTube as well because that's where I found them.
Yes, sir.
Hell
yes,
yeah, sir. Man. And everybody look out for the golf tournament and keep your peepers out for the link that I'm going to post here in the next few days of the nonprofit where you can help donate.
I love it. Appreciate the support, Will, and the opportunity to come in here and spit shit and talk about, you know, career and just hockey and fighting and everything that comes with it.
Anytime,
man. And the medal too, man. Keep that shit going.
Fucking A, man. Anytime. I appreciate you, Les.
Love it, Will.
Yep. Have a good night, buddy.
Thanks for listening, Biscuit Babies. That was Les Borsheim, Colorado Eagle. Just a true fucking badass. Love talking to that guy. Really enjoyed his story. He's just a fascinating guy, man. Just a cool dude. And I wanted to give a shout out to Fourth Line Voice. You know, I had mentioned Randy Ponde in there, and Les is another guy that Fourth Line Voice had turned me on to, you know, over the past few years that we have been friends. So I recommend you go over to Fourth Line Voice, his website, and, you know, kind of find some of these diamonds in the rough. Guys that had fought previously, and you can really really learn a lot and find a lot of good people and a lot of good fighters if you're interested in that thing. And obviously you are if you're listening to Biscuit, since we tend to have that more style, excuse me, a player on here. Go rate and review us. I want to get 1 million reviews, so I need every single one of you to leave a review. Thank you. Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, Google Play, all that shit. We're on all that stuff. Thank you guys. I really appreciate it. I'll start reading some of these reviews if you guys are into that. If that's something that's you're into, I'll start doing that. Because there's a lot of good ones on there. I meant to bring the thing out to read them today, but I didn't. And it's getting late, so I'm not going to do it right now. Thank you. Thank you, HockeyFights.com, for presenting the show. I love you guys. Talk to you soon.